Okay, so before I start, a quick poll. Who here works with REST APIs or uses REST APIs? Okay, lots of them. Who has tried to secure a REST API? Who has tried to secure a REST API using JWT? Okay, but I'm going to talk about that now, so maybe some of you will learn something new. For those of you who know everything, so, bonsoir. So, my name is Tamás Piros. I work as a principal technical instructor at this wonderful database company that you already heard about called Marklogic. I do have a portfolio page. On there, you can find links to my GitHub profile, blog posts, etc. So, feel free to visit that. Twitter handle is also there, so feel free to ping with any questions or just send me funny cat videos or whatever you want to do. So, before we get into the topic of securing REST APIs, we're going to talk about the two types of authentication that exists, right? There's the server-based authentication, and I stole this picture from that website. So server-based authentication means that you have your API. So this is the server side, this is the client side. So you have your API that wants to access the website or something on the client side. Then in the client side, you provide the username and the password. That gets sent to the server. The server is then going to verify whether that username and password combination is correct. And if it is correct, then it's going to create a session, and then it allows you to communicate securely between the server and the client. Now, normally that information is stored in the client side as well, in the form of a cookie or something else. Now, the problem with this is that when you scale, managing these sessions from the server side can get very complicated. Why? The sessions are stored at the server, right? They are stored in the memory of the server. Now, if this server scales, the servers need to know which client authenticates with what session, and then where does the client, and so where does the server store that session, and how does the client find it? So if you scale this out, it becomes very, very complex, okay? So that's one of the issues with server-based authentication. The other type of authentication that exists is what we call the token-based authentication. So again, we have the same structure, server and client. We have the API that wants to talk to an application. Then the user logs in, provides the username and the password. That gets sent to the server. Now, because token-based authentication is stateless, nothing gets stored on the server, okay? But what gets created is a secure token. Based on the token, the client and the server can now communicate with each other. And that token is not stored at the server side, okay? So it's very important that token-based authentication is stateless, okay? There's no storage of state in anywhere in this process. So, in light of that, we have what is called JWT. It's written as JWT, it's pronounced as JOT, and that's short for JSON Web Tokens. And JSON Web Tokens is really just an open standard that tells you how information that you have should be shared between the server and the client in a secure format. And at the end of the slide, I actually have a link out to the actual standard definition on IoT.org as well. So it's really a standard. And when you work with these JSON Web Tokens, and you're going to see an example of that, it is really just a JSON object. Okay? And the JSON object consists of these three individual parts, and they are separated by the dot character. So there is the header, there's the payload, and then there's the signature of the token itself. Okay, so we're going to take a look at these individually now. So the header is very, very simple. It just defines the type of the token, in this case it's a JOT token, and the hashing algorithm used, okay, HS256. I have it in the notes what that means. Key-based hashing algorithm, blah, 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 and generates you a 32-bit long key. Okay, you can change that if you want. There are multiple algorithm types that are supported by the JOT standard. Okay, so this is what you have in the header, only these two pieces of information. Then comes the exciting bit, which is the payload. So in the payload, the JOT standard, the specification for the standard, specifies a few properties that you can use. Okay, so these are, let's call it, built-in properties for the JOT. The first two are such examples, IAT issued at time. So that's the date and time of when a particular token was issued, and then DXP is when the token is going to expire.
Exactly.
And there are additional JOT claims that you can add that are specified by the standard. Okay, so there's, I think, 6-7 more. But what's very important is that as part of the payload, you can also specify your own claims. So you can add your own properties to this JSON object, such as a username, or such as whether this user is admin or not. Okay, and you can add additional fields in here as well. So this is the place where you can create or add user created information. Okay, it doesn't have to be called uname, you could call it user, username, it's really up to you. And then the signature itself consists of the header in a hash way plus the payload plus a secret word. So if I were to programmatically create my token, this is how it would look like. So I would have an encoded string where I have the header encoded plus, very important, the dot character plus the payload itself encoded, and then the whole thing hashed with a secret. Okay? Now, when we talk about the code, which is not now, it's very important that, and I need to point out that the secret should never be stored in your code as it is now. Okay? So that secret should probably be in Node.js, that should be an environment variable. Okay? Somewhere set up in your system. Okay? Never store secrets in your code like that. Okay? And never write secret as your secret.
Just remember,
please, yes. Nor write secret like that. Okay? Because that doesn't work either. So that was about JOT, and obviously the whole point of securing this REST API is to start using these tokens in Node.js. So how do you use that? Well, luckily there's a package that exists, so that is called JSON Web Token. I made the mistake of trying to look for the JOT NPM package, and I think there's a very funny package that exists with that name. It's definitely not what this does. Okay? So just remember that it's called JSON Web Token. And in that package, you get functions that allow you to sign a token, to verify a token, and to decode the contents of the payload given a specific token. So in this example, how many lines? 5 lines. We create a token. So we require the NPM package, we create the secret. I also create an expiry date, so expiry time, so that the token that we create later on is going to expire in an hour. Then I create the payload. This is another variable. As I said, the payload can be anything, just a simple JSON structure that you see here. And then I create the token by calling the JSON web token npm packages sign method. What I do, I pass in the payload, the secret, and an additional parameter. This is how that particular implementation of JOT requires you to specify the expiry date of the token. Okay? And with these few lines, we've essentially created a token. So what do you do next? So in the example that we're going to see, we're going to have a very, very simple REST API that has 2 endpoints that is created using Express.js. Okay? You could, of course, use any other NPM package to create a REST API, right? I wanted to say Happy is another one, I think, that you could use. So what we're going to do in Express, who here knows middleware functions in Express? Okay, so for those of you who don't, imagine that you create an API endpoint of /API/devs, okay? So every time when you create an API endpoint or an endpoint using Express, it has 2 parameters. It has a request and a response. Like, you know, normal website operation, there's a request and there has to be a response. A middleware function allows you to manipulate what happens between the request and the response. So you get the request, then as opposed to sending the response, you can call a middleware function that does something, maybe checks for a username or password, and if that matches, then it sends you the response. If it doesn't, then you can stop that request and produce an error message. Okay? So that's a middleware function. And the middleware function can also just output the time of the request. So do something after the request has come in and before the response was sent. So what we're going to do
for what I've done, is that we're going to create this middleware function that verifies the token, i.e. it will see whether the token is really valid. If it's not, we return an error message. If it is, we're going to extract information from the payload, and we're going to do some other things in there.
Does this make sense? From a conceptual point of view.
Okay. So, this is it. So what we have here is, obviously this whole authenticate thing is a function, okay? Up to this line, we have the authenticate function, which is the middleware function. So what it does, it has a request, it has a response, and it has this thing called max, which I'm going to tell you what it does. The first thing that we do is we check for the existence of the authorization header. And you're going to see why this is important. It's very important because when you work with token-based authentication, the actual token must come in via the header called authorization. So if that doesn't exist, you can already send back an error message to the user or to the API itself saying that there's no token, right? That we can't do anything further. If there's an authorization header, we need to split that because the way, I'm going to show that to you as well, the way the token comes in is you have the keyword bearer space followed by the token. So the actual token is the second element of the array. Okay, so that's why we split on space, get the second element of the array. And then we use, obviously what's missing is the usage of the JSON web token npm package. So you would use the jobs.verify method, you pass in the token, you pass in the secret, not in code. And then you get the standard Node.js callback stuff, right? First argument is an error, second argument should be the actual decoded token. If there's an error, meaning that either the secret is not good, the token is invalid, anything that's wrong, we send back obviously a console log message and we send back a status of 401, meaning that that particular request cannot be authorized. Else, so if there's no error, we go and access the properties that were sent in by the payload. Okay? So we can access the username, the admin, and notice what I do there, I can attach that to the request as well. So later on in my code, I can access request.username, and I should have the value from the actual payload. Okay? And notice this next method called there. What that does, it basically, as I said, the request comes in, you start to process it. If everything works fine, then we can call next, which will allow us to send the response. Okay, notice here, I'm not sending next, because I want to error out right here. Okay, whereas here, my token is fine, I extracted the data, so I call next, and then I get the response. Okay, so there's this next function called there. And then how do I apply this authenticate method? I don't know if you can see that in the bottom here. We have a standard express route definition. So we say, to read out, just ignore this authenticator, what it will do, if someone goes to the /API/characters endpoint with the HTTP method of get, this function would be called whatever it does, okay? But if we pass in this authenticate method as a first argument to our root definition, it's first going to invoke this, right? Then let's say our token is valid, it's going to call next, and what is next to call? The actual processing function, okay? If the token is not valid, so if it's 401, the next method doesn't get called, therefore this will never be executed. Okay?
Demo time.
So, what I have in here is a very simple piece of code. Can you guys read that? Is it large enough, or should I make it? So, what we have, really just standard express stuff, right? Require the express package, create a router, require a JSON web token, MarkoGK API and settings for Marko. Okay, that doesn't actually matter. We start our application on port 8080, let's ignore authenticate first, and then we have two, let's also not read this, so we have two root definitions, okay? /API/characters, /API/equals, okay? So, again, just in pure English, if someone goes to the /API/characters with the HTTP method of get, I want to invoke this function, characters. What does that function do? Goes out to my database, there's a username check, doesn't matter, we're going to talk about that, queries the database, returns me some character name stuff, okay? And it sends that back in the JSON format. That's all it does. And then the vehicles function returns me names of the vehicles, okay? So, let me do this real quick. So if we start this up, I use Postman to, I'm going to zoom into this as well. So Postman, who uses Postman? Okay, for those of you who don't, it's a Google Chrome extension that allows you to test web services in a really, really easy way. So you specify which HTTP method you want, so get HTTP, and then we have localhost 8080 slash API slash characters, and there should be a send button somewhere. Okay, so what we get back is a list of Star Wars characters. Okay? And if we go slash vehicles, let me get Star Wars vehicle names back. Okay, so it's like just a simple API just to demonstrate something. So let's say we want to now secure the... So we don't want people to be able to access the name of the characters. We want to make sure that they provide a token, so they actually authenticate it. Okay? So what we need to do, we need to call this authenticate middleware. Okay? This is exactly the same that you saw in this slide. Okay? So, as I said, we're just going to go and write authenticate in here as a middleware and then have characters. I'm just going to restart this process. So if I now start Postman again and zoom in, what I get back, as opposed to the character names, is the message no token provided, right? Because with my request, I did not provide a token. So, we need to do something about that. Now, just to keep things simple, what I've done, I've created a script that just creates me a token. So I'm going to zoom in. So this is how a token would look like. And what I want you to notice, anyway, you can kind of see that, right? So there's a dot there. Okay, so header dot payload dot somewhere else signature. No, this is the same. But anyway, you get the point, right? So this is the whole token that we were discussing. So what I can do, I can go and copy this last line, and notice the bearer keyword here. I'm going to copy this whole token and paste it to Postman. So I'm going to send this request with a header, and as I said, you need the authorization header, and you don't only send the token, but you send the keyword bearer, space, and the token. Okay, so that's exactly what I copied. So bearer, space, and then here, header dot payload dot signature. Okay, now let's send this request. It's not running. I need to start the service, obviously. Okay. Unauthorized. Oh, I did this before because there's a space in somewhere here. When I copied the token, there was an extra space. Okay, so we send the token, and now that we have the token, we are actually seeing the data itself. Okay? And now, if I modify anything in this token, if I change something in the header, just remove that E. Okay, I get unauthorized. If I remove that hyphen. Basically, no matter how we modify this token, or that the token itself is going to give you unauthorized because that is no longer a valid JSON job token. And just to show you one more thing, what I did comment out here. So you can say if requested username, so you can make additional checks. So requested username. So remember there is a payload as well, and I think I have. We can just check this real quick. When I send in a token, which is not going to work now. That should work. Okay. In my log, you see that I get extracted, or I can extract something from my payload as well, as part of the code, okay? Because now the request object has that username property somewhere here. No?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I add the username property to my request, which is from the decoded token. And then I can access that inside my root definition as well and print out the value. Okay, so this is how you can work with the payload as well. Now, obviously this is just a very simple example to show you how you can, using this middleware, how you can secure parts of your REST API. The full picture, and this is what GeoPhoto 2 does as well that you saw, is that obviously you have a user interface. Someone types in the username and password, they hit login. We then send that information to the database. We check whether the username and password is correct. If it's correct, we sign a token, and then that's the token that's being used for further authentication, right? So if anyone alters that, then you don't see anything in that application, okay? I'm not showing that because that would be a bit more complicated, but hopefully this gives you a good idea and understanding of how JSON web tokens work and how token-based authentication works. And let's see. Okay, so there are a few resources. This is a blog post that basically discusses exactly this, but a bit more in detail with some additional resources on how to, you know, how Jot works and stuff like that. This is the GitHub repository, so you can set up the same project if you want to. It's exactly the same. You get the data, characters, unicorns, stuff like that. This Jot.io is a very good website. A very good resource because it allows you to visually debug your JSON web token, right? So you can paste it in here. It tells you what algorithms you use, so what's your header, what's your payload, and what's your signature. And you can change your secret, and if everything is correct, then it will say signature verified. If something is incorrect, like you had the wrong secret, then of course you have an invalid signature. So it's just a good website to test your tokens against. This is the standard for Jot. And just to, I'm pasting this in here, that was a question, how markers would be different from MongoDB. There's another blog post for you, so you can read the differences in there. I don't have a slide that says questions, but questions?
Yes. Why did you use the bearer keyword?
I think that's how you need to pass in the a token. When you send the authorization header, I think it has to go with bearer and then space and then the actual token.
But that's how it was done with the basic oath. But I'm not sure, you know, the HTTP basic
oath. Oh, oath, yeah.
Basic oath. That's how it was done, but
yes.
I'm pretty sure you don't need to write down because then you have to split it and, you know, pass the string.
You need part of the HTTP specification. It's working if you don't put it there, but just to be concise and to be spec compliant, it's better to have the bearer keyword.
You see, I learned something. Because I just used it because that was an example. It's good practice. That's the hard answer. Did someone here want to ask? You had enough of me, Anna. Yes?
Why did you say, why you advise us to don't put our secret in the code? Because Node.js is server side.
It's still server side, but I don't know. It's just having secrets and passwords and all that stuff written in your code, inline your code, it's just to repeat myself, it's not good practice. So,
I might have One of the reasons, if you put in your code, you're probably using a code versioning system. So it means your secret will be also on GitHub or Bitbucket or whatever you are using. So if you give permissions to the repository to the wrong person, it won't be good. It also means if you have a growing team, you might not want to have the same person responsible for development and the production system. So developers shouldn't know the secrets used in production, obviously, so they can compromise the systems online. So it's, for those reasons, it's always better to have the secrets on configuration files that can be managed locally by developers for themselves, and to help production people to adjust values as they might from them and to secure the application or exactly what they want it themselves.
And also one more very lame reason is because you would be very surprised how many times you go on GitHub and you see people committing their code with usernames and passwords and secrets right in there. And then you just go on there, you just review the history of a commit, and then everything's there. You know, like Heroku deployment passwords and everything. So again, obviously, you know, when you just develop on your own machine and you code, as you can see, I store it in there as well because it's easy to explain, you understand, you don't need to look for stuff. But imagine if I would, if this would be part of, I don't know, the Geophoto app, and we would, you know, as a marketing company, release that, and at some point I would have Git committed that whole stuff, you know, with the secret and everything onto GitHub, then I would not have a job probably. No. So it's just in a nutshell, it's good practice.
And also, if you put your secret in your code, if it's compromised, if you have to change it, you have to redeploy all the applications. If it's in an environment variable, you have to change the variable.
Yeah, so if your secret, what he was saying is that if your secret gets compromised, you need to redeploy your whole application with a new secret, so there's a new, you know, whole process around that, which you probably don't want to go through. Because while people are doing that project, you're probably looking for a new job already anyway. So. Okay, so any other questions? Okay, so you saw my portfolio, I have email address there, you saw the Twitter handle, and with that I will try to say this message for you.